Amen, amen, amen. How is everybody doing this morning? I didn't hear anybody out there. Are you still sleeping? Are you ready to praise the Lord in this place? You ready to give him honor and glory? Did you come expecting to receive something from him this morning? Amen, amen, amen. We serve a mighty God. He's good. He's worthy to be praised. He is faithful. Amen, amen. You are the head and not the tail. You are above and not beneath. That's something to celebrate about. Are you ready to worship God this morning? You ready to stand on your feet and give him praise? Give him honor and glory in the house of the Lord. Amen? Hallelujah. Let's go sing in Rock of Ages.
All our praise. Salvation that cannot be moved. He's proven himself to be faithful and true. There is no rock, there is no God like ours.
Come on, sing that again.
There is no rock, there is no God like our God. There's no other name that's worthy of all our praise. The rock of salvation that cannot be moved. He's proven himself to be faithful and true. There is no rock, there is no God like ours.
Come on, sing it out, Rock of Ages.
Rock of Ages, Jesus is the rock. Rock of Ages, Jesus is the rock. Rock of Ages.
Hallelujah!
There is no rock, there is no God like our God.
Come on, sing it out to him.
There's no other name that's worthy of all our praise. He's a rock of salvation that cannot be moved. He's proven himself to be faithful and true. There is no rock, there is no God like ours.
Rock of Ages!
Rock of Ages, Jesus is the rock.
Rock of
Ages, Jesus is the rock.
Rock of
Ages, Jesus is the rock. There is no rock, there is no God like ours.
Rock of Ages, Rock of
Ages. Jesus is the rock,
Rock of Ages.
Jesus is the rock,
Rock of Ages.
Jesus is the rock. There is no rock, there is no God like ours. Oh, there is no rock, there is no God like ours. There is no rock, there is no God like us.
Oh, that's good news, church. Celebrate them this morning. Woo! God is mighty. Isn't he worthy to be praised? Oh, yes. You excited in this place? Oh, yes. How many people are excited for the Lord? Then give him a mighty shout of praise in the house of God right here. Hallelujah. He is so worthy. Amen, amen, amen. You're so beautiful, Lord. You're so beautiful. We just want to honor and bless your name. Give you all the glory that you deserve, you rightly deserve in this place. Thank you, Lord, that you are the beautiful one. Thank you. You are the Christ, the Lord of lords and King of kings. Hallelujah. The one who was and is to come. That's something to celebrate. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord, worthy to be praised. Sing how wonderful he is.
Wonderful.
Lord, you're beautiful, you're wonderful, awesome in this place, worthy to be praised. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Do you love the Lord this morning? Do you love him? Do you want him? Do you want to give him all of you because he gave you all of him? Amen. Thank you, thank you. Let's keep our mind, our heart, our eyes focused on the Lord this morning as Pastor Frank blesses you with this.
My mind.
Declare that. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Bless the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Lord, we lift your name. Your name is above every name. We lift you on high. We give you all the glory. We give you all the honor. You are worthy to be praised. Lord, bless the King of Kings. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Let's worship him, church. Let's worship him. Let's get excited about the Lord Jesus this morning. Come on, sing, Lord, I lift your name.
Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. So glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us.
Yes.
You came from heaven to earth to show the way from the earth to the cross.
God, God is good, right?
Yes, he is, Pastor.
Are you excited to be in the house of the Lord? Did you receive something during praise and worship? Did you come expecting?
Yes.
Remember I said that. Did you come expecting? Amen. Well, we just worshiped the Lord with our song and our praise, and we're going to continue to do that with our giving. So if you guys need to get an offering envelope, raise up your hand. The ushers will make sure you guys get one. You guys may be seated. How many people know the Lord loves a what kind of giver? Are you cheerful?
Yeah.
Are you excited to give?
Yeah.
What are we giving to? Right? What are we giving to? The advancement of the gospel. You know, Matthew 6:33 says what? Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. You know, we get hung up in those, that holy sounding word. You guys hear me say this a lot, right? That word righteous. Well, if you take the us out of it, it just means right, right? Seek God's right way of doing things. And what's God about? I always say this, you guys have heard me say it before, but it bears repeating. God is in the people business. And he was the first human resources department, right? So what's he concerned with? Is he concerned with what's going on in the world? Is he looking out there and saying, oh, well, this doesn't look good? Or did he make a plan of redemption through his son for us to spend eternity in heaven and still have an awesome, prosperous, good journey here on earth?
That's right.
And he did, right? So what should we be doing? Has every one of us been called to a ministry? Now, I'm not talking about the fivefold ministry, although you may be called to that. But we've all been called to what? The ministry of reconciliation, winning people over to the Lord. By how? Advancing his kingdom, by seeking his kingdom. And the really good news is, as we seek God's kingdom, he can't help but bless us, right? He can't, because he's made, it's a spiritual principle. You know, so what does that have to do with offering time? Well, everything. As you guys sow into this church, what are you doing? You're advancing the kingdom, right? We're advancing the gospel. Many of you know this, some of you might not. We're a tithing church. What does that mean? 10% of every offering that comes in here goes to support other ministries, like Uttermost Ministries. You know, guys know, we have seed in the ground in Samoa, Fiji, Vanuatu. You know, the Bible says Jesus won't come back till the gospel's preached to the ends of the earth. Well, you guys are sowing seed in the ends of the earth. You know, literally going into villages where they don't even know what bread is. Think about that. What's ice cream? They don't even have refrigeration. But yet, we're reaching the kingdom, we're reaching them sold, their souls, for the kingdom of God. Right? That's where your finances are going. You guys have seed in the ground. If you participate in our offerings, you have seed in the ground. Brother Keith Morris Church, Faith Life Church, Sarasota and Branson, Rhema Bible Training College, right? Rhema Church, you know, where our roots go deep. You guys have seed. And what does seed do? It produces. Produces what? After its own kind. What does that mean? As you guys sow your seed, you better be expecting and believing to reap a return of that seed. But God is so cool, right? When you plant a tomato plant, I'm not a green thumb kind of guy. You know, I could water it and tend a garden and it just still doesn't work out. But God's way always works out, right? But when you plant a tomato seed, right, when you get a tomato back, is there just one seed in it? There's a lot of seeds. What does that mean? God's in the multiplication business. Can you say amen? So as you guys sow into the kingdom, remember to water your seed. Keep thanking God for the return of your harvest. So what? Now that seed is multiplied. What does that make you? A bigger giver, right? Because now you're sowing off the bigger seed you've returned. Confess it every day. Lord, I thank you that my harvest is coming in. And don't grow weary in well-doing by watering your seed. It's not about your timing. God's timing's perfect. Your harvest may be coming in the next 5 minutes. Don't give up on it. Keep watering it. Right? Keep warding it in prayer and confession and watch it spring up. Amen? Glory to God. That's good news.
That's great, right? News.
Let's pray. Father, we thank you for the privilege and opportunity to sow into your kingdom. We recognize it as you who's given us the ability to get wealth so you may establish your covenant here in the earth, Father. And we thank you as the earth remains seed time and harvest time, that every faithful giver that gives and sows into our church and the ministries that we support by it, since we're a tithing church, Father, that their seed will return multiplied. And we thank you for it. We thank you for overflowing, running over increase coming into our lives, Father. And we thank you that every debt here at the church is being reduced and eliminated, that we're getting our buildings, our lands, our vehicles, no mortgages, no debt. And I plead and declare and decree that same blessing over those who are faithful to give, that your houses are paid in full, your cars are paid in full, your land is paid in full, and you own everything. No mortgage, no debt, no financing, no interest. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. You guys may receive the offering. Amen. Yeah.
lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life.
We're glad, Lord.
I'm so glad you came to save us.
You came from heaven to earth to show the way from the earth to the cross. From the grave to the sky, Lord, I lift your name on high.
One more time, come on.
Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises.
Every day, Lord.
I'm so glad you're in my life.
Thank you, Jesus.
I'm so glad you came to save us.
To show the way from the earth to the cross, my debt to pay, from the cross to the grave, and from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift your name on high.
You came from heaven.
You came from heaven to earth to show the way from the earth to the cross, my debt to pay, from the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift your name on high.
Lord, I lift your name.
Lord, I lift your name on high.
Lord, we lift your name.
Lord, I lift your name on high.
Lord, I lift
your name on.
Morning, church. Praise the Lord. Good morning. Good morning. Well, it's announcement time, but first, before that, do we have any first-time visitors? Any first-time visitors? We won't make you dance. We just want to say hello.
Yes, we will.
Hello, hello, hello. Good morning. Good morning. Good morning. Everyone looks so beautiful. Yay. You know, I was thinking when you were praying about, you know, over the offering, we should say daily confessions. I am blessed. I am prosperous. I am healthy. I never lack for any good thing. Doesn't the Word of God say that? He gives us everything that pertains to life and godliness. That's no lack at all, ever, 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 ever. Amen. All right, so we have some announcements. Do we have food today? Oh, it says food today, ? Oh. Okay, so we'll be having membership class July 31st. If you are a new member, you haven't received your little laminated membership card labeling you as Abundant Grace Church member. It's July 31st. The sign-up sheet is at the reception desk. So if you haven't signed up, just go there and put your name on the little sheet, okay? All right. Men, we're planning a trip to Rhema for the Call of Arms, men's conference out in Rhema Bible Training Center, Rhema Church out there. The men go out there, and it is November 3rd through the 5th. You can see Pastor Frank for more information on that. Pricing is around $785 to $800, depending on, you know, what the airfare is and things like that per person. That's your airfare. That's your hotel. That is going in with the guys in a van or car, whatever all of you can fit in. It's a really great opportunity to just get plugged in with faith men, which I know changed Pastor Frank's life when he came back. He was a new person, hasn't looked back since. It's been wonderful. Here we go. This is awesome. Sunday, August 7th at 5 p.m., we're having praise, worship, and pasta night. We love worship nights, don't we? We love worship nights. It's going to be amazing. And then we get to eat some really good pasta after that. 5 p.m. September 11th, we have our church picnic immediately after service. You can come dressed for the picnic. But you can come dressed however you want to dress. Come for the picnic. And we usually have people bring sides, whatever you want to bring. If you want to bring sides or whatnot, we can, you know, you can bring whatever you want to do for the sharing table, right? We have a sharing table. Yeah. And we have service times. We have service times, obviously, Sunday, 10 a.m. We have Wednesday night service, 7 p.m. every Wednesday. It's been fantastic. It is being led by the Spirit. So Pastor Frank's doing that series, and it's been wonderful. Also, we have Faith and Healing School from Tuesday through Friday, 10:30 a.m. So come out with that. We also have our women's outreach on Thursday evenings, 6 p.m. So invite a friend, come out, bring them. Women's outreach is probably about an hour, and we stay and we, you know, have fellowship together afterwards. And it's been wonderful. Amen? Amen. Pastor?
Amen. God is good, right? That was nearly good enough. God is good, right? All the time, because he is good. Just a little addition to the announcements that Jody mentioned, and I didn't put this on her notes, was that picnic Sunday, which is September 11th, Patty and James from Uttermost Ministries will be here, and Patty's going to be ministering. So you definitely want to catch that, and you want to get in line to get your food before James gets there, because James likes to eat. No, that's because he works out like 47 hours a day, so glory to God. If you have your Bibles, turn over to Luke chapter 5. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for an opportunity to be here this morning. We thank you for the truth of your word, and we come to you as touching this service, asking you and thanking you for the anointing that is on your word, that would break every chain of bondage, every yoke of anything the enemy would try to bind us up with. And we thank you for the truth this morning, Father. We thank you for revelation, Father. We know when the word goes forth, it will never return void for those who are ready and expectant to hear it. And we thank you, Father, that we will see change in our lives once we apply what we hear today. And we thank you for it all in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. So during praise and worship, I told you guys to remember a word. Expect. Expect. You know, there's too many believers, too many Christians that are walking into churches today with no expectation of anything. What are they doing? Just going through the motions. Just going through the motions. You're going to church today. Why? Well, that's what we do. That's what I do. That's the way I grew up, right? In a denomination going, hey, it's Sunday. We got to go to church. And my Sundays at church were probably like five times a year. You know, I always used to say that. My mother would say, did you go to church? Well, I went to church. I was in the parking lot. I took the pamphlet that somebody dropped in the parking lot and said, Ma, I was at church. Come on, I'm not the only one. Come on now. I can have a line, right? I can have a prayer line for line. No. My point being is there's too many believers not going through the motion or just going through the motions. Today is Sunday. I'm going to church. And I want to talk about this morning. I want to talk about expectancy. Expectancy. Because if you're not expecting to hear from God, guess what's going to happen? You're not going to hear from God. It's just that simple. And my heart's, God put this on my heart. Jody said to me last night, she goes, what are you ministering on today? I was like, Joe, I actually don't know. Because literally, God's got three things going around on the inside of me. Right? Three different things. And of course, they all line up with not only what Pastor Eddie's been talking about, but also what I've been talking about and ministering on, and everything was converging together. But we need to expect. We need to expect to hear from God. And we can't just go through the motions. You know, how can we be non-expectant of God and expect to receive what we're believing him for? And then what happens? We get disappointed. We get discouraged. And we're tempted. Who's the tempter? Who's the one who wants to bring lies? Who's the father and author of lies? Whose whole personality is deception? He wants to get you into a place where you not only don't receive God's best, but you blame God for it. There's angry Christians out there right now, and they're angry at God. But yet they did nothing of their own to lay hold of the promises of God by faith. And that's expectancy. So I told you guys to turn over to Luke. Luke chapter, did I tell you chapter 5?
Yeah.
All right, so I want to start in verse 17. This is a story, this is scripture that we've probably all seen a bunch of times, but that's dangerous. When, if you, and I'm up, this is not about condemnation. This is about change, right? If I just said to you, turn over to Luke chapter 5, and we want to start reading in verse 17, and you're going to say, well, man, I've heard this before. Guess what you just did? You're not expecting. You're not expecting to receive anything. I've heard this before. So have I. A lot of times. I've heard it preached. I've preached it, right? I've read it. I can't tell you how many times, right? I try to go through the Gospels one time, you know, every 2 or 3 months, back through the Gospels, right? So I've read this a lot. But faith and revelation are progressive. I don't know about you. Scripture I looked at 15 years ago meant something to me then and means so much more to me now. Because revelation comes and revelation is progressive and faith is something we need to grow. How do we know we need to grow? Well, guess what? Every single one of us has been given the same measure of faith. Nobody, so-and-so, brother so-and-so. Man, they're a faith giant. They started out with the same measure you had. Guess what they did? They grew their faith. And they received from God by expectancy, expecting to receive something from God. So Luke chapter 5, verse 17, I'm actually reading this out of the New King James, says this. Now it happened on a certain day as he was teaching. Is it kind of odd to find Jesus teaching? Jesus still teaching? Every minute of every day. But Jesus was operating as 100% man here on earth. Do we have a teacher that's available to us 24/7, 365 days a year? And you guys know I always say that. Yes, that's 366 days a year on leap year. The Holy Spirit's available to teach us constantly. But how so often is he going to teach us and guide us? Through the Word of God. So Jesus was teaching, and we just resigned ourselves to the fact that Jesus is still teaching today. It happened on a certain day as he was teaching that there were Pharisees and teachers of the law sitting by. Could we say there was naysayers around? Looking, not expecting to receive from Jesus, looking to find some fault in him. The world is still looking to try to find fault in Jesus. Think about that for a second. If you share with somebody that doesn't know God, if you say, well, you know, I believe God. I believe in God. They're usually pretty much okay with that. As soon as you bring up Jesus, man, they run for the hills. You think that's coincidence? Teachers of the law sitting by who had come out of every town of Galilee, Judea, and Jerusalem. And the power of the Lord was present to heal them. Was the power of the Lord present to heal the naysayers as well? Heal them. For God so loved the world, he gave us his only begotten Son, that so whosoever believes in him. God so loved the world. Every single person that's been born, every single person that's on planet Earth today, and every single person that ever will be born. They could have been expecting to receive something. That wasn't their attitude. I didn't want to talk about, we're not talking about them this morning, though. Then behold, men brought on a bed a man who was paralyzed, whom they sought to bring in and lay before him, meaning Jesus. And then when they could not find how they might bring him in because of the crowd, they went up on the housetop and let him down with his bed through the tiling into the midst before Jesus. Stop there for a second. These guys bring their paralyzed friend. They carry him in on a mat. They get to the house, and they're confronted with a barrier. It's too crowded. Can't get inside. What are we going to do? Well, we may as well go home. We're not going to get in to see the master. That barrier you're up against in your life this morning, whatever that is, you guys know what that is, whether it's sickness or illness or disease, whether it's lack of some sort, financial lack, whether it's a relational problem, is your barrier. But how many people in here know you can't have a breakthrough without a barrier? If you have nothing to break through, if you don't have a barrier to break through, you can't what? Go to a higher level. Well, wait a second. I don't like that thing I'm up against. It's not good. I know. But you're a barrier-busting Christian as soon as you start expecting to believe and receive whatever what's already been bought and paid for you on your behalf. Do you know every single battle you're ever going to fight, you've already won? Think about an army in the natural. If they said, well, we already know we're going to win every fight, then what should we do? Let's fight. Too many Christians are shrinking back, not realizing the power they have and the authority to use the power in the mighty name of Jesus. So these guys are not discouraged by a circumstance. They face a barrier. What did they decide to do? Well, you know what? Did they come there coincidentally? Or did they hear something about Jesus? We've been talking a lot in Faith and Healing School, in my time in Faith and Healing School, about seek and see, right? Hear. They heard, right? When we seek, when we look to go deeper in the things of God, into his word, we're seeking. And when we seeking, when we start seeking, we start seeing some things, right? So they heard something about Jesus. They didn't just pass by and said, hey, there's a crowd, let's look. They purposed in their hearts to pick up their friend and his mat and his problem, which could be your problem, and decided, you know what? We're going there to see this teacher. And they get there, and there's a crowd. Oh. No. Actually, I was getting ready. I was getting dressed this morning, and I just got this in my spirit. I was meditating on this scripture because I knew we were going to be talking about it this morning. Then they went up onto the housetop. Now, if you think about it in Jesus's day, people would be like, really? They tore through the roof. The houses were made out of like clay, straw, so that was 100% possible to do. But the staircases in Jesus' day were on the outside of the house. So they didn't have to go into the crowd because they couldn't get in there to climb up to the roof, which was an outside staircase. But the Spirit of the Lord spoke to me this morning as I was getting ready and said, that's an illustration of a necessity to go higher in the things of God to get what you're believing him for. They literally had to get higher. Would it make sense in the natural to say, let's climb onto the roof and let's dig a hole? Guys, if somebody comes through this roof right here, I'm going to freak out a little bit. I'm just letting you know. Whoa! Yeah, thank God. We have full access, right? And they let him down on his bed through the tiling, and did they put him in the back of the room? So Jesus, I can picture Jesus, and if any of you guys have watched The Chosen, he's like sitting there like, and there's dust and things, debris, and they lower him like right there, right in front of Jesus. That's where you need to be. When that barrier says, stay out, you can't come in to get close to the master, you got to climb upstairs, dig a hole in the roof, and get right at his feet. Amen? When he saw their what? Their faith. He said to him, man, your sins are forgiven you. Verse 21, and the scribes and the Pharisees began to reason, saying, who is this who speaks blaspheme? Was the power of God present to heal them? How was their attitude? Were they expecting anything? Can we see ourselves through those eyes? Really? Is the word of God really true? By Jesus' stripes, I'm healed? Come on. It's a story. No, it's not. It's a redemptive reality. And that word, I know you guys, we say it all the time. By his stripes you were healed, in the Hebrew means cured. Who can forgive sins but God alone? But when Jesus perceived their thoughts, he answered and said to them, why are you reasoning in your hearts? Which is easier to say, your sins are forgiven you, or to say, rise up and walk? Jesus is still saying, rise up and walk today. Get up. Do something. But Lord, you don't know what I'm going through. Yes, I do. Get up and do something. Get closer to me. Have you ever had a time period in your life where you're going through something and God felt like he was so far away? He's just as close as he ever was. It's us who are too far away because we're so preoccupied and we're meditating on our situation, not the things of God, which is our answer and our solution. I can't find anything I've ever gone through in my life that isn't dealt with in the Word of God. Rise up and walk, but that you may know that the Son of Man has power on earth to forgive sins. He said to the man who was paralyzed, I say to you, arise, take up your bed, and go to your house. Immediately he rose up before them, took up what he had been laying on, and departed to his own house, glorifying God. You know, there's two illustrations in the Bible that I can think of right now off the top of my head. We have the man by the pool of Bethesda who was laying on a mat. This guy was brought in on a mat, a sleeping pad, whatever you want to call it, right? And you know what, to me, that's a representation of? He was stuck in a comfort zone he should have never been in. Do you think God's happy or is cool with you guys just being in a comfort zone? Me too. This goes for me. Just kind of coasting along, wishing and hoping like the world does? Or do we need to do something? Do we need to get up and start building our faith so that our faith can expect the goodness of God that's already yours? Immediately he rose up before him, for them, took up what he had been lying on, departed to his own house, glorifying God. Does sickness, illness, or disease ever glorify God? There are Christians out there who actually believe that healing is not for today. We talk often about the watered-down gospel. And that just ain't so, folks. Healing is for today. Is Jesus for everyone? For God, we already said that. For God gave his only son. And he's because God so loved the world. So that's one. Is Jesus the Word made flesh? Yes. Yes. So he gave his only son. Jesus is the Word made flesh. And does the Word say, by Jesus' stripes you're healed? Yes. Settled it once and for all. Healing's for right now. Yep. That simple. Didn't pass away with the last apostle or disciple that went home to be with the Lord. It's for today. The men who brought Jesus came what? Expecting something to happen for their friend. Did they come there? Would they have dug through the roof if they weren't expecting something? Or would they have given up at the door when it was full? They were expecting. They were so eager for a one-on-one personal encounter with the Master. And quite honestly, in my heart of hearts, the Bible doesn't tell us, but I think it was not only for the man, for themselves as well. They wanted to be encouraged knowing and seeing Jesus raise up their friend from that bed of sickness. They expected something to happen. And guess what, guys? The deeper you dig, the closer you get. I don't know how thick the roof was. Let's say it was a foot thick. That first inch probably seemed like it took forever. They got deeper, and they got deeper, and they got closer. And, you know, have you ever maybe dug something as a kid sideways, like a sideways little tunnel? You know, you used to build forts in the sides of, like, rock piles and stuff. And as you dig, you like feel like you're getting nowhere, and all of a sudden there's that little peak of sunlight. As we dig deeper, we start to see the truth. We start to see what's ours. Hold on to that. We're going to come back to that. Well, my question to you this morning is, what are you expecting? Hold that to yourselves. But the reality is, we can't expect what we don't know belongs to us. I'll say that again. We can't expect what we don't know belongs to us. We have to walk in the truth of the whole Word of God. F.F. Bosworth, I don't know if you guys have ever read this book, Christ the Healer, said this: faith begins where the will of God is known. Faith begins where the will of God is known. Do you know what His will is? Well, yeah, you know, His will is that all be saved. That's certainly His will. That's not all of His will. Does He have a will for your life here on the earth as you're spending the least amount of time you're ever going to spend, which is here, before you go home to be with the Lord? He does. In that scripture we just looked at, verse 20 said, when He saw their faith, He said to him, man, your sins are forgiven you. So, can we conclude that we have a right to expect the will of God for our lives? Not only do we should. But we have to know what His will is. Things like divine health and healing, financial prosperity, relational prosperity, our children blessed, generations down the line blessed, saved, walking in their divine calling, your marriage blessed, long life, favor of all kinds. Anything you do, any transaction you make, big or small, expect favor. We have to expect the will of God, though. How? By faith. Expectancy comes by faith. You know, if we're expecting something, what does it mean? I said this, I think, on Wednesday night. Is faith for something you have right now? It's for something that's not now and not yet. If I give my wife, I'm not giving you this, but if she says, I'm believing you for $100. Well, she knows I would do that for her, but take what? Diamond earrings? Okay. All right. Lord, need your help here. Jody's believing for diamond earrings, or asked me for them, right? And she doesn't have them yet. Well, she's got to put her faith on it because she doesn't have them. It's not now and not yet. If I give her those diamond earrings, does she need faith for that anymore? No. Faith is for something that's not now and not yet. Romans 8, 20, what was that? Amen. Lord, you know what she wants for Christmas. Amen. Romans 8, 25 says this, but if we hope for what we do not see, we eagerly wait for it with perseverance. Too many believers are claiming to believing God for something, but are not waiting for it with perseverance. They're growing weary in well-doing. Is there a patience component tied to perseverance? It actually is patience. You went through the drive-thru last night with the grandkids. How long did it take you to get there? 10 minutes? 5 minutes? So you got what you wanted instantaneously, pretty much. Christians act that way. I want a drive-through experience with you, Lord. I'm believing you, Lord, but I want it and I need it now. Yeah. I can picture God sometimes going, dude. That's what He talks to me, by the way, just so you know. Dude, do you not understand in that wait time where you're spending time with me, while you're laying hold of my promises and my will by faith, I'm growing your faith. I'm making you stronger in that weight that feels like a desert for you. I'm building you up. Because why? Something, as you grow in the things of me, you have a real adversary who comes not except to steal, kill, and destroy. And I'm going to make you stronger for that next round that he's going to come against you, that you're going to defeat that. And I'll be glorified and magnified, and people will get saved. We need perseverance. How many women in here have ever been pregnant? Like all of you? Could anybody have talked you out of the fact you were expecting a child? Took a pregnancy test? Or not? I know back in the day there's a lot of dead rabbits, but so the pregnancy test when you took it was positive. Did you have faith in the fact you were pregnant? I'm sure as you began to grow, right? You had all the symptoms of the pregnancy, maybe morning sickness, maybe pickles and ice cream were the thing, I don't know. But nobody could talk you out of being pregnant. Now, before your children were born, did you start setting up a nursery? Did you get diapers? Did you have a baby shower where everybody gave you everything? Was the child on the scene yet? No. Do we not say when women are pregnant, they're expecting? Oh, there's that word again. Expecting. Expecting what? That child that they know they're pregnant with to be born. It's an easy illustration. It's the same way we believe God. Are you a born-again child of God this morning? No. Then you should have all the symptoms to expect God's best for your life. Faith gets ready. Just like you did when you were pregnant. Faith gets ready. I was talking about this in Faith and Healing School last week, I think. Anybody ever know the story of Dodie Osteen, Joel Osteen's mother? She was diagnosed with terminal cancer, and I believe she was given 3 months to live. So she didn't go cower. She didn't go say, that's it, it's over. She got into the Word, and she got pictures out of herself. Pictures of herself when she was healthy and whole, and put them all over the house. What did she do when she walked into every room of that house? Saw herself as God sees her and saw her in that condition. Look, if you're dealing with sickness and illness and disease, God doesn't say you're sick, ill, whatever. That's the way I see you. No, 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 no. I see you based on my plan for you, my will for you. I see you healthy, whole, and healed. The problem is we don't see ourselves through God's eyes. And that's the danger of not going deeper with God and digging through that roof, not expecting anything. Do I or not? You guys hear me say this a lot. God will never disappoint us. But unfortunately, we disappoint God when we don't believe him for anything. Like if you sit here today saying, I'm not believing God for anything, start believing him for something. Yeah. That's how our faith grows, right? The men who brought the paralytic to Jesus were fully persuaded by faith and had what? Expectation that Jesus could do what they believed he could do. And like I said, faith is for something that's not yet. It's for something, though, that will breed expectation in your life. If you see in the Word what belongs to you, and we continue to go deeper, we get ourselves to a point where not, can anybody talk you out of your salvation? No. How'd you receive it? By faith. It's the same with every single promise of God. Well, healing, I see it, I believe it by faith, and I can't get talked out of it. And when we can't get talked out of it, what does it lead to? Expectation. What can I expect when I die, when this body dies? I'm going home to be with the Lord. And we can rejoice in that before we have it. We can rejoice in anything we're dealing with, that we know God's will is covered, it's covered under God's will, and rejoice in it before we have it. What is that? Faith. And faith does what? Faith brings expectation. And in this particular case of Scripture, the expectation was that their friend who was paralyzed would be healed. Because why? It's the will of God. Romans chapter 4, verse 21 says this, and being fully convinced that what he had promised, he was able to perform. Has God promised us anything? There's a lot of promises in the Word of God. But do we need to know what they are? I said this the other day, too, in Faith and Healing School. Do we need to know how something works to receive the benefit of it? If I push that button in my truck to start it, do I need to know all the mechanics behind how it starts? Or do I need to just believe it'll start? I don't know how God does everything. Someday I'll ask. Right? But the reality is I don't need to know how everything works to receive the benefit of it. All I need to see that it belongs to me, it's mine, and I'll take it now. One of my favorite verses of Scripture, Hebrews 11:1. And I want to read this out of the Young's Literal Translation. Says this: "And faith is of the things hoped for, a confidence of matters not seen, a conviction." You know what faith does? Faith lights the fuse of expectation in our lives. When we see it's ours and we begin to stand on the word for what we believe that we've seen and we know is ours, that faith kindles expectation in our hearts. You know, I was thinking about how many believers, again, it just hurts my heart that people are walking through this life with a knowledge, you know, saved, but kind of stopped where it started. You know, never went deeper. And guys, it's really important. There's a huge difference between head knowledge and heart knowledge. I've met a lot of people that can quote Scripture from Genesis to Revelation, but yet don't apply the Word of God to their lives. That's head knowledge, right? That's head knowledge. Faith takes the Word of God and applies the Word. You know, we always talk about this phrase being so dangerous in Christian circles. Let go and let God. No, God's done everything he needs to do. It's already yours. It's already ours. But my Bible says we need to what? Lay hold of the promises of God by faith. To fight a good fight of faith. I don't know about you. Some of the battles we've needed to fight over all these years seemed way too big for us. But glory to God, they're never, ever too big for our God. But you're going to be doing a lot of fighting. You're going to be doing a lot of standing. You may even be crying a little bit. Right? I said this to Jody the other night. Tears to me are healing tears. You know, have you ever cried when something's going on in your life, but the tears that you're crying aren't necessarily for the situation? They know because you know your deliverance is coming. You know, despite what we feel, are we in company with anybody? When Jesus was in the garden, under pressure, blood. But Lord, not my will, yours be done. Faith is confidence. And when we know the will of God for our lives, we need to do what? Start receiving it by faith. I told you we would get back to this. I want to get back to what I talked about earlier. The guys who brought the paralytic expected something would happen for their friend, right? The deeper they dug, the closer they got to Jesus. Are we willing to do the same? And guys, if there's nothing going on in your life, if there's nothing happening, do not, I'm going to say it again, do not put it on cruise control. Go deeper. Keep digging. Too many people go running for the Word of God after the circumstance already comes when they should be built up in it before it does. Would you expect a natural army to go into combat without its weapons? And then we'll go there and then get it. We need to go into every battle we face armed. Because we've been given the weapons, and the weapons of our warfare are not carnal. Based on what we just talked about, I want to read this out of my notes. It's a recipe for expectancy. Knowing the will of God for us, receiving it by faith, which leads to hope, which we know is a confident expectation that we can expect God to do what he has promised us. And how does faith come, guys? By hearing and hearing and hearing and hearing. We can never stop hearing. We can never stop hearing. Go over to, I wasn't planning on going here, but we're going to go here. Go over to Joshua. What did I tell you, Joshua? Yeah. Let's go to Joshua. Where do I want to go specifically? Let's go to Let's start in verse 1. Reading this out of the Amplified. Joshua 1:1. After the death of Moses, the servant of the Lord said to Joshua, son of Nun, Moses' minister, Moses, my servant, is dead. So now arise, take his place, go over this Jordan, you and all this people, into the land which I am giving to the Israelites. You think Joshua felt a little overwhelmed by this assignment? Hey, Moses is, you know, the guy who led you out of Egypt and all in the wilderness and all that stuff and all the battles you fought? Yeah, he's dead. Your turn. Every place on which the sole of your foot shall tread that I have given you, as I promised Moses, from the wilderness and this Lebanon to the great river Euphrates, all the land of the Hittites, Canaan, and that was their promise. God has a Canaan land prepared for you. And what is that Canaan land? A land flowing with milk and honey. What does that represent? God's supernatural provision of all kinds in your life. That simple, right? Are we going to receive it just by doing nothing? We're going to have to fight for it. And remember, right, and Brother Keith Moore's comment, if it can get in the ring with you, you can whip it. And to the great Mediterranean Sea on the west shall be your territory. No man, this is important, no man shall be able to stand before you. Does that sound like no weapon formed against you shall prosper? Does the word of God say a weapon won't be formed? No. But does it say it will prosper? No. But are you going to need to do some standing? So no man shall be able to stand before you all the days of your life. As I was with Moses, so I will be with you. I will not fail you. I will not forsake you. That's a promise of God. That's his will for your life. And we need to start receiving it by how? By faith. Regardless of what you see in the natural. Be strong. Where does our strength come from? And in the Amplified, that word strong in the Hebrew means what? Confident. Did we not just say that faith breeds a confident expectation? And of good courage, for you shall cause this people to inherit the land which I swore to their fathers to give them. God's promises, his provision is your Canaan land. And God's saying, you know what? I've prepared it for you. Fight for it. Stand on my word, and it's yours. Amen. Amen. Only be strong and courageous that you may do according to the law which Moses, my servant, commanded you. Turn not from the right hand to the left, that you may prosper wherever you go. Now, I read the setup to get to verse 8. And you guys should be familiar with this. This book of the law shall not depart out of your minds? Out of your mouth. Wait a second. When I'm expecting God to do something based on his promises, under a better covenant than Joshua had, I should be speaking some stuff? Not only should you be, you better be. And this goes for me too, because so often we're challenged with a temptation to speak the circumstance, not the word. And when we do that, we become a mouthpiece for the enemy. But you shall what? Meditate on it day and night. Pastor, I don't know how to meditate. That thing you're dealing with, how often have you thought about it today? Oh yeah, you know how to meditate. We're just meditating on the wrong thing. Now meditate on it day and night. Now, can you physically, while you're doing the things of your day, like I'm standing here with you guys, can I meditate on the word day and night? Yeah, it's for, what does that mean? It's foremost in the front of my mind. That you may, and here's the other important part, and this is where it's important to be not just hearers of the word, but doers of the word. That you may observe and do according to all that is written in it. Should we be hearers of the word only? Well, Pastor, you just said faith comes by hearing. It does. But our receiving from God goes by an obedience to do what the word tells us to do. Now, whether I see in the word that by Jesus' stripes I'm healed, and I stop there, and I don't put a work behind that faith, and I walk around going, oh, this hurts. Oh, I can't believe this doctor's report. Isaiah chapter 53, verse 1 says, who's believed our report? This report, which trumps every report. And observe to do according to all that is written in it. For then you will make your way prosperous, and then you shall deal wisely and have good success. We got some stuff to do. These guys, and I forget about our friend here, these guys heard something about Jesus. Their faith grew. They had an expectation that if they could plant him right at Jesus' feet, he was going to get his healing. Amen. Are we willing to do the same thing that the men who brought the paralytic did? Are we willing to go deeper? I don't have time, Pastor. You do. Can I borrow your phone? I wasn't going to go here either. God, you're good. You're just cool. All right, let's see. I don't have time, Pastor, to go deeper. Where the heck is your calculator? There we go. All right. How many days in a week? How many hours in a day? 168 hours. If you go to work, say 8 hours a day, 5 days a week, that's 40, right? Minus 40. And if you sleep 8 hours a day, that's 56, right? 8 times 7. Let's say you go to church on Sundays, minus 2, approximately, sometimes 3. Well, I'll give you an extra one, 3. I want to finish this message today. Never going to happen. Okay, so you have X amount of hours in a week. You work, you sleep, you come to church on Sunday. And if you tell me, I can't go deeper, I just don't have the time, you're left with 69 hours a week to not go deeper with God. Waking hours. Meditation. Yeah. So, if you still think you don't have time to spend with God, and I was going to do this, this was the other message that was on my heart, but we wound up here anyway, come see me after service, and you better be like coming up to me like this, because I'm going to disprove you can go deeper with God. 69 hours. It's a lot of time. Matter of fact, I'll put this challenge out here. I bet you could even double and triple it up. You guys still love me? Are we willing to dig deep? Now, can we also say expectancy is an attitude? What was your attitude this morning coming to church? Happy. Can't wait to get there. ready to receive something from the Lord. That'll do what? Facilitate change in my life. Or were you grumbling and complaining? It's too early. I'm tired. I don't feel like going to church. I'm going to sit home and watch the news. I've got... Hang on one second. Your feelings betray us every time, right? Have you ever caught yourself saying this? And I'll call myself out. I've had this too. Thank God, not recently. I'd rather be doing something else. Talk about forsaking your... I don't even know what to call that. It just ain't good, right? Dumb. Dumb. Ms. Carroll said dumb. Spiritual mom said dumb. It's dumb. It is dumb. Do you think any believers did that this morning? I'd rather do this. We made other plans. Look, we all go on vacation, we go away, other things come up, 100% okay with God. You know, resting and relaxing is part of what we should be doing. Scripture even tells us about some individual, I always mess up the pronouncing of his name, so I'm not going to say it, almost died for overdoing the work of the ministry, right? But what was our attitude this morning? Philippians 2, verse 14 and 15, again, this is out of New King James, say this, do all things without complaining and disputing, that you may become blameless and harmless children of God, without faults in the midst of a crooked and perverse generation, among whom you shine as lights of the world. If we think about this, a lot of your friends and your relatives know you're a believer, that you're a Christian. What if you asked somebody to come to church? And that day you happened to decide to have something better to do, they showed up. I had no intention of saying that, so that's for somebody. Should I say it again, or was it once was enough? If you invited somebody to go to church and they have just happened to show up on that day you decided to do something else, that hurt. Don't think it hasn't happened. Yeah, I went to your church, but you weren't there. But I saw on Facebook you were out like at the beach. I said all that to say, with what you say, we are never going to win souls to the Lord by hitting them over the head with the Bible from Genesis to Revelation. Oh, you wicked sinner, repent or you shall die. Doesn't that sound all like biblical? It's actually weird, right? Or, man, I love God loves you, man. Oh, but you don't know, if I walk in that building, it's going to collapse. Well, I walk in, it's still here. I think me and Pastor Eddie had a contest the other night of who was worse in our past. I'm not telling you who won. Who was worse years ago? Or him. Let's put it this way. It was neck and neck. I'm not going to ask you. I just didn't go to Bible school first. But if you're watching, I love you. You know that. But the reality is, right, people are watching us. It's not about hitting them over the head with the Bible, but if you profess the love of God to them, you invite them to church, God is so good, man. You got to plug in with this awesome body of believers we had. They're awesome people. They're going to love on you. They're going to help build you up, and you went to the beach that day. And I wanted to look at an attitude of expectancy in a couple different versions, a couple different ways inside our preparation this morning for coming to church, right? And I want us to, I'm really trying to provoke everybody to look on the inside. You know, check our hearts, right? We saw these guys expecting to receive something, and they received something. Their friend got healed. But we talked about faith that leads to hope and expectance. Right, but just looking at an illustration of today, did you get up, like I said earlier, and come expecting to hear something that was going to be life-changing? You know, what was our attitude this morning? And guys, I can see myself, and as I'm ministering this, I'm thinking about my whole walk with the Lord over all these years. You know, where I've missed it along these lines, right? When we were out in the cafe this morning chatting about what we don't have yet, what hasn't happened yet, everything that's wrong. If we're doing that, we're not in faith. We're wavering. Does Mark 11, 24 or 5, one or the other, say, a man who wavers shall not receive much? What are we doing? Looking to the left, looking to the right. How did that work for Peter walking on the water? Was Peter walking on the water? Or was he working on the word from God? Peter, come. Come and be healed. Come and be made whole. Come and have a lifestyle of nothing lacking, nothing broken. Come possess your Canaan land. But Lord, look around me. What's our attitude like? Are we professing to have faith and then speaking death? James 1:6 says this, but let him ask in faith with no doubting. For he who doubts is like a wave of the sea driven and tossed by the wind. For let not that man suppose that he will receive anything from the Lord. You guys have heard me say this over and over again, and I'm going to say it again, because I know the importance of it. So many times in my life, God's spoken to my heart. Yes, of course, in a message from somebody ministering, but during praise and worship. During praise and worship. You know, and if we're saying things, you know, I really don't like that song. It's not my favorite song. I wish Pastor Frank didn't sing that song and George did. Too bad. That's not what praise and worship is about. Right? And we have to prepare our hearts to praise and worship. Worship is first and foremost an encounter with the living God. And it's only as real as your involvement. And if we come here with an attitude like, yeah, I don't like that song. Why did they pick that song today? Back in the day when we had a couple of worship teams, it used to be like, I don't like that worship team. I'd rather the other one. And we're expecting to receive something while we're, what are we really doing? We're grumbling and we're complaining. I pray this often when we start music ministry. Lord, we aren't perfect. We don't need to be perfect musicians. All we need to do is make a joyful noise unto you. Amen. And I don't care if I hit the wrong note, whatever. It ain't about that. This is not a performance. This is praise. A true worship experience is often a direct result of preparation for worship. I know what we do on Sunday mornings. I get up, I read, and then I'll be honest with you, I watch a couple of fishing shows from Isla Mirada. And then me and Jody, as we're getting ready, what do? We put on praise and worship. Get in an attitude of worship. And we as believers should take it. Every advantage to worship. Psalm chapter 81, verse 1 through 3 says this, sing aloud to God our strength. Make a joyful shout to the God of Jacob. Raise a song and strike the timbrel, the pleasant harp with the lute. Blow the trumpet at the time of the next moon, at the full moon, on our solemn feast day. David was the one who instituted worship in the temple. Worship should involve all of us, wholeheartedly, 100%. The whole person. And music does what? Lifts us up and brings our thoughts and emotions to focus on God. We all have our favorite songs. I get that. But every song that Scott is about the word and glorifies and magnifies Jesus and God is an awesome song. right? And guys, you can come on up here. We're actually going to close out with a song. And then during the message, right? I already alluded to that a little bit earlier. Oh, he's going to minister on that again? I've heard that before. Matter of fact, I was listening to so-and-so on Christian television, and he just ministered on it last night. Well, I'm expecting something then. Revelation is progressive. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing the word of God. Why is it so often that I've heard people say, and I'm a listener by nature, and again, this isn't about condemnation, but if the Lord's dealing with you in this area, then he's dealing with you. Well, I've heard people say something like, I didn't get anything out of that message. And then two people over say, I just had my breakthrough. Mm-hmm. They came expecting. They expected nothing. Mm-hmm. It's true, guys. Matthew chapter 7, verse 7 says, ask and it will be given you. Seek and you will find it. Knock and it will be opened. When we come expecting by faith, Lord, come on in. And lastly, during when we close and we give a salvation call, right? It's important for you guys to stay hooked in by faith. Look, I know people have things to get to, things to do here at the church. But if you don't, you know, stay put. Join our faith together to pray for those. You know, our whole desire is that every person we encounter be saved. You know, when we get up and start, when we shift our focus from, hey, I just was in and listening to an anointed message, but now I got to go, you grieve the Spirit of God, right? Allow the Holy Spirit to be seen in our actions. Otherwise, we quench it. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 16 and 19 says this, rejoice always, pray without ceasing. In everything, give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. Do not quench the Spirit. Amen. You know, I firmly believe, based on, and I guess you guys kind of know that based on today, is my heart's desire is that everybody come expecting, right? Because when we expect, guess what's going to happen? We're going to receive, right? And we need to receive. You know, anybody in here believe in God for something? Everybody in here should be believing God for something. And God wants to meet each and every one of us exactly where we're at, you know? And with that being the case, let's stand on our feet. Good, good Father. Magnify him right now. Magnify him. Say, Lord, thank you so much. Thank you for your goodness. Thank you for your mercy. Thank you for your loving kindness, Father. We magnify you. Thank you, Lord. You've given us provision. Provision in all areas of life. And that your will includes all those promises of provision. And we reach out and receive them by faith right now. We don't care that it looks like we don't have them. But we do have them because you've given them to us already, Father. And we thank you for it. We thank you. Healing is ours. Financial prosperity is ours. Our blessed generations down the line belongs to us. That you've made that Canaan land promise to each and every one of us. The land flowing with milk and honey is ours to possess. But Lord, we thank you. You've provided us the strength and the faith to fight the good fight, knowing that we've already won the victory because you've provided for it through your son, Jesus. And Lord, we thank you. You are so, so good. You are so, so good. Thank you, Father. Thank you for being our need meter and our source. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Glory to God. You know, we never want to close any of our services without an invitation. And I apologize for not welcoming everybody on live stream earlier. And this goes for everybody in here and you guys on live stream as well. You know, we talked a lot about expecting to receive from God, you know, and that God's plan of redemption was a complete plan through Christ. But if you don't know Christ, we have no plan that's complete yet. But that can be changed today. With every head bowed, every eye closed, I just want to give an invitation. We never want to close the service without giving an invitation to receive Jesus into our hearts. To have that no-so experience. You know, hell's a real place, heaven's a real place. And I know I'm going to see most of you, if not all of you, in eternity. But if you've never professed Jesus as your Savior, your Lord, your healer, let's make that right this morning. So if you've never accepted Jesus into your heart, I just want you to raise up your hand and we're going to pray. We're going to pray with you and we're going to take care of that this morning. So nobody looking around. I'm just going to, not going to beleaguer this, but, and same thing for you online. If you've never received Christ, just type in the comment section and we will make sure we get over to you some answers, some prayer, and some materials into your hands. So, all right, glory to God. Everybody here is saved. So if you're saved, reach up both of your hands. All right, hallelujah. God is good, right?
All the time.
He's a good, good God. Let's go singing, all right? You guys get something today, I hope. We're going to expect and expect and expect, right? Because guess what? Just like the baby's birth, God will birth what you're believing him for. Amen. Hallelujah.
Stories of what they think you're like, but I heard the tender whisper of love in the dead of night, and you tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. You're a good, good father. It's who you are, it's who you are, it's who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am, it's who I am, it's who I am. Oh, when I've seen many searching for answers far and wide, but I word, you're a good, good father. It's who you are, it's who you are, it's who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am, it's who I am, it's who I am. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. Come on, church. You are perfect in all of your ways. To us,
you are perfect.
You are perfect in all of your ways. Oh, you're perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. To us, oh, it's love. I can hardly speak. He's so unexplainable. I can hardly think as you call me, deeper still as you call me, deeper still as you call me. Still in the love, 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 love. You're a good, good father. It's who you are, it's who you are, it's who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am. am. It's who I am. You're a good, good father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. To us. You are perfect in all of your ways. Oh, you're perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. To us. Yes, you are, Lord. Were you blessed today? Pastor Frank had an awesome message, didn't he? Amen.
Hallelujah, guys. Go in the joy and the peace of the Lord, and we'll see you guys during the week. Amen.